and it's something important for us. He's incredibly wise and all patient. Thank you.
Yeah, so guys, I developed this curriculum. It's actually a 5-part series, and maybe if it works out, I can do the second talk with you guys when I get back, after Thanksgiving. But I am one of the Sigma Chi advisors, and I've been in the Greek system now for about 31 years. I pledged 31 years ago. My senior year decided to work with fraternity guys full time. So you guys are the reason I do what I do. I've had opportunity to be a pastor probably about 5 different times, but I turned it down because I'd rather help you guys. You guys are at a very strategic time in your life. What I'm going to talk about today is not so much starting, but how are you going to finish. You know, I want to congratulate you that you're a part of one of the best fraternities on this campus, ATO. When you guys get initiated, your pledge class gets initiated, it'll be one of the biggest fraternities in the nation. I don't know if you realize that, but Sigma Chi, KA, ATO, we're the biggest fraternities in the nation here at Ole Miss. It may be the same with Phi Delta, Kappa Sig, I'm not sure, I'm pretty sure, but we're a part of a solid heritage. But what I want to talk to you guys about today is your decisions affect all of us. They affect me over at the Sigma Chi House, they affect every bit of us. And I'm going to share several stories with you to kind of help you think about that.
Yeah.
Hey, man. The first thing I'm going to show you is in my office, I've got this picture. And I don't know if you guys have read Flags of Our Father, John Bradley. But actually, James Bradley wrote a book about his dad. And this is a really fascinating picture. You know, it's the most printed picture of all time, raising the flag of Iwo Jima. It's really the most famous flag, but these guys raised this flag about 7 days into the campaign, and they didn't know it, but there's still over 14,000 Japanese in the background. Less than 100 Japanese would give up, and there's 6 guys that raised this flag. John Bradley's in the background, but only one of these guys, John, would go on to have a normal life. Ira Hayes would drink himself to death. This guy in the front right here, he would be killed by a mortar a couple days later. A few of these guys died by snipers, but only one of these guys went on to have a normal life. And like I said, congratulations, you're part of a great fraternity. But my question is, how are you going to finish? You're starting well, that's awesome that you're here. My son's a pledge over to Sigma Chi right now, and I'm proud of him going through Rush, but I'm more concerned about how are you guys going to finish. What I want to do is I'm going to propose a definition that I put together about 7 or 8 years ago. I borrowed it from a pastor out of Arkansas. I felt like our pledge programs were good, but I felt like our pledge programs were not great. I felt like we had kind of a vacuum in how we were training you guys to be men. So I'll give you my definition, and then I'm going to talk about it. First of all, my question to you is, what does it look like to be a man? I've killed over 100 deer. I've killed over 80 turkeys. I can prove in a court of law that I've had sex at least 3 times because I've got 3 kids. If I cashed out on my rural property right now, I'd probably walk away with about $3 or $4 million. But does that really mean I'm a man? I mean, how do we define manhood? A lot of times in the frat world, that's how we define a man who's killed a lot of game, a lot of sex, a lot of this, a lot of that. But there's a lot of men that have done more than me in those categories, but they're not living like men. Let me propose a definition for you. A true man rejects passivity, he accepts responsibility, he leads courageously, and then he invests in younger men. Okay? A true man rejects passivity, he accepts responsibility for the way he treats women, his pledge brothers in this chapter, okay? And ultimately, he invests in younger men. I want to talk about women first. Rejecting passivity, Augustine back in the 300s said, your natural tendency as men is to be passive, and you have to overcome your passivity to be men, to be the type of men that you're created to be. A study was done a couple years ago, and it said your generation is living like children, and you're kind of graduating out of children into boyhood now, and you're going to live like boys till your mid to late 20s, and then finally you're going to think about becoming a man. But you're going to waste 5, 6, 7 years of really good manhood time if you choose to live like a child for the next 5 or 6 years. So first of all, let's talk about rejecting passivity and leading in the way you treat women. Guys, the culture has changed a lot in the way you treat women. If you do something to a woman sexually, you date rape her, or you do anything as far as sexual misconduct, it's your word against her. So I'll give you a couple examples. Just last year, we had an Ole Miss guy meet a girl at a bar. They had consensual, both agreed to get into a taxi, to go back to his apartment. They consented to have sex. And afterwards, which probably, I guess she sobered up, she said, you know, I didn't consent to have sex with you. And $10,000 later, that guy was expelled from Ole Miss. A law student last year, the exact same thing happened to him. He met a girl in a bar. They consented to go back to, I think, her place. They had sex. And a little while later, she said, you know, I didn't mean to have sex with you. I didn't want to have sex with you. She sued him. That's a felony. And now he can never practice law, even though he graduated from law school. Guys, you've got to be responsible, not for how much just you drink, but how much you give your date. Because if your date drinks too much, she can tell her dad, or she can tell the police, like she did. One of my buddies who was a private investigator here in town, a girl got a police car with one of my buddies, who's a private investigator, drove around one of these big apartment complexes, and she said, you know, I'm pretty sure he date raped me, but I'm not sure what apartment it was, which means she drank too much. Which means she can say, if she wants, that you put something in her drink, and then you are up a bad creek, and your chances of making it are slim and nil. So I'm telling you, as someone who cares about you, and I want to see you guys succeed, you've got to take responsibility for the way you treat women. Are any of you guys familiar with the article that was written by Rolling Stone a couple years ago about the UVA campus? All right, let me catch you up on it. So my wife and I think that this girl was date raped. She claims by several guys in a fraternity. But it was probably like some of these scenarios here at Ole Miss where she didn't know who the guy was, so she was so hurt she came up with a story. And the story was, she came over to the fraternity one day, so a guy took her upstairs and a bunch of guys jumped her and two or three guys raped her. And she reported it to Rolling Stone. They wrote an article, it went public. I read the article 2 years ago when I was sitting on a deer stand, and the dean of that university, UVA, shut the entire Greek system down. It was the first time a decision by one or two guys cost all of us our charters. We were all shut down pending an investigation. Come to find out, her story was mainly fabricated. I think, though, probably some guys from that house did attack her, did rape her, but she was so hurt she wanted to come up with a story. All right, another reason you've got to be careful with how you carry yourself. Are you familiar with the ATO chapter at Georgia Tech, what happened a couple years ago? A guy gets online, he talks about, kind of gives ingredients of how to get a girl drunk so you can rape her. And they didn't say Joe Schmo at Georgia Tech did this. It was ATO at Georgia Tech did this, and they jerked their charter and they were gone. You've got to be careful, guys. If you're at a party and you get on a mic, you got to be careful what you said. So last spring at Derby Day, we had a Sigma Chi who probably had too much to drink, and somehow they let him have a mic at Derby Day, and he asked some inappropriate questions to the girls, and they almost kicked us off campus. We're the longest-running Sigma Chi chapter in the nation of over 150 years, and one guy almost cost 250 guys our charter. One guy. It just takes one guy. So I really want you guys to think about the way you're treating women. You need to think about treating women with respect and integrity, because I know that's what ATO is about. All right, let's talk about your pledge class for a minute. You guys have got to be responsible for each other. A couple years ago, a Fidel had too much to drink, and he started arguing with his pledge brothers about getting the keys to his truck. And finally, after he argued, they were like, fine, here's your keys. And I passed his Bronco out here on Highway 6, flipped, and he was dead. So guys, if one of your pledge brothers has had too much to drink, man up and be willing to say, hey man, you've had too much to drink. Let me call a taxi or let me get you a ride. Because I'm a campus minister here at Ole Miss, I get a phone call probably once a year of a frat guy that's killed himself, somehow got himself killed. Two falls ago, I got a phone call from the KAs, and I'm always honored to go over there and be kind of there to console the guys, but it's very sad when I hear a lot of times how guys get killed. This particular KA had mixed some alcohol and drugs, and he just died on his couch. But what was even sadder is that his pledge brothers knew he had a problem and nobody was willing to say anything to him. Guys, part of being brothers now, and you're going to hopefully be ATO brothers here pretty soon, is manning up and being honest with each other. And if one of you guys has a problem or one of your friends has a problem, part of being a man is saying, hey man, you can cuss me all day long, but you know what, dude, I think you've got a problem. And I care about you. That's why I'm willing to say something to you. After all that happened with the KAs, the house mom asked me to address alcohol in front of the entire chapter. Okay, the biggest KA chapter in the nation, 250 guys. She wants me to stand before them and talk about the elephant in the room, and that's alcohol. Here's what I came up with. I really thought long and hard about it because, you know, I don't to be the bad guy, or I don't want to be the campus minister. I want these guys to respect me, but I don't want to be offensive. So here's what I shared with these guys, and this is something I would challenge you just in life. So about a year ago, I got a phone call from an insurance company. I had to up my insurance coverage to about $3 million because of the real property I have in town. And this insurance company called me. They said, Isaac, we're going to ask you some questions. It's not that we have anything against you, but if we're going to insure you for $3 million, we want to know some answers to some questions. So I said, okay. So they asked me, do you smoke? How often do you smoke? Do you drink? How many drinks do you have? Do you fly a plane? How often do you fly? Do you own a plane? Do you jump out of planes? I mean, the list went on. It was like 25 things they asked me. What's interesting, a week after they called me and asked me those questions, I had met the owner of the hub over here, and he crashed his plane flying out of Conway, Arkansas, and died. I was in a club last year. We had a big hangar at the club. And, you know, if I told you guys I bought a plane, you'd think, there's nothing wrong with Isaac. He bought a plane. I mean, a lot of guys own their own planes. But what if I flew my plane every day and I didn't get it serviced? You see, having a drink, or having a cigar, or having this and that, it's okay to, in moderation, but you need to be careful because your culture really promotes abusing those types of things, and when you abuse those things, you're really putting your life at risk. Matter of fact, I've been saying this to the sororities lately, if you're going to go out on a weekend, and you really, it's an option for you to meet a girl at a bar and take her home and have sex, and you're wanting to insure me, let's say I'm an insurance guy, and you're wanting to take out insurance, and I'm going to cover you on having a life of joy and happiness, I'm not going to insure you. If you have it's literally an option for you when you go out to the square, that, you know, you're totally cool with just hooking up with a random girl and going home and having sex. Because that means you're on the road to being like most of the fraternity guys that I know that are my age now, in their mid-40s here in Oxford, most of them are on their second and third marriage. There's a good chance, guys, when you live your life like that, you act like hell and you live like hell, your life's going to be a living hell. There's a really good chance one day another guy's going to sleep in your bed with your wife and raise your kids in your house. Okay, let me say that again, because Oxford's full of those kind of guys. I was at Auburn for 4 years. That's where I met my wife. But I graduated from Arkansas. So I know it goes on in Fayetteville, I know it goes on in Auburn, and I know sure as heck it goes on here in Oxford, because our neighborhood's full of these types of former marriages of former white fraternity guys like you guys that went to Ole Miss. Now, somebody else is sleeping with their wife in their bed, in their house, raising their kids. So guys, you've got to think right now, I need to have a plan. Let me ask you this question. Where do you want to be in 15 or 20 years? What type of man do you want to become? Because you cannot become what you are not becoming. Does that make sense, guys? You cannot become what you are not becoming. You can't live one way now and all of a sudden switch on the light and one day live a different way and all of a sudden meet a great girl. The type of girls you're dating right now and you're hanging out with right now, that's the type of girl you're going to end up marrying. Okay? Let's go 28 years ago. It's my senior year. I'm at Arkansas. Kappa is a really good chapter there. The pledge trainer asked me to come and speak to their pledge class. So I speak to their pledge class. I was a chaplain in my fraternity, so I shared some of the same types of things I'm sharing with you guys. I just shared it with the girls. And after I left that meeting, several of the Kappas told the pledge trainer, man, that guy's a really sharp guy. That's the kind of guy we want to marry one day, but not necessarily date right now. In other words, those few Kappas were saying, I want to live my life a certain way right now, but somehow, miraculously, I'm going to end up with this great marriage one day in the future. You know what it would be? I'd be interested to find out where those girls are now 30 years later. I'd love to ask them, hey, how did it turn out for you? How did it work out? Because you lived like you wanted to live, which it sounds to me you wanted to live like hell and act like hell. I wonder how it ended up for you. And I bet it didn't end up good for them. Okay, so we've talked about taking responsibility for women, your pledge brothers. Now this chapter, I want you guys to be thinking about not just how active you're going to be one day, but what kind of officer are you going to be? Hopefully all of you are going to think about taking some sort of office in this chapter. I lived in the fraternity house as a freshman. Okay, we actually lived in the house as pledges. I was the first door on the left when you walked in the house. It sucked to be me, okay? I lived there for 6 months. When guys wanted to come by my room, they knew exactly where I was, so I went real quickly to keep my mouth shut and do what I was told. But I lived in the house my freshman year. Did you know I moved back in the house my senior year just to be there to give back to my fraternity? I went to every chapter meeting. I ate every meal at the house. I went to every party because I cared. cared about my chapter. I wanted to give back to my chapter. Don't fall into temptation your senior year to just go and build your own resume and kind of build a kingdom for yourself. Give back to this chapter. Be thinking about, hey, what do I want to do my junior year? What do I want to do my senior year? But then be thinking about this. Am I living my life right now? And you're getting ready to go home for Thanksgiving, so you can really evaluate yourself right now. A lot of you guys are probably going to be hunting. You're going to be sitting in a deer stand or a duck blind. Really evaluate your life right now and say, man, how am I doing? Because ATO is not concerned about your past. We're concerned about your future. Think about when you come back next semester, what type of man are you going to start to become? And then are you going to become the guy one day that other guys respect so that you can invest in younger men, which is my last point. My desire for you guys is that you will be the most respected pledge class that's come through ATO in a long time. That you'll be the guys that will invest in younger men and you will make this fraternity. There's some great guys in this fraternity. When this house burned down 12 years ago, I know I showed you guys a couple weeks ago, I keep a burned brick in my office to remind me of this chapter. It always reminds me that life goes by quick. We never know when our life's going to be gone. And before you know it, you guys are going to be graduating and you're going to be gone. But what will this chapter look like as a result of you guys? All right, remember my friend that I started with. Remember, you started well. You were part of a great chapter, one of the biggest chapters in the nation for ATO. But how will you end? Let me pray for you guys, okay? Father, I pray for these men. Lord, I pray for discernment and wisdom and discretion. Discretion meaning making the right decision at the right time. Lord, I pray that these men would grow in integrity and character. I'm more concerned with what type of men they are when nobody sees them. Lord, I pray that these men would think about what type of man they want to become and that they would be making choices right now to become what they want to become. Father, I pray that you protect them over the break, that you bring them back to this chapter, and Lord, that you continue to make this one of the greatest ATO chapters in the nation. Lord, we praise you, we thank you, and we lift all this up in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate you all.